Welcome to the second day of ILTA conference. Today we have a distinguished speaker, Professor Dr. Belgin Aydın Hocam from TED University as the head of the ELT department, and also she has been coordinating the Center of Teaching and Learning since March 2020. And previously, for years, she had studied at Anadolu University at Eskişehir. Also, she had worked as the director of the School of Foreign Languages there. She had her undergraduate and PhD degrees at Anadolu University, ELT department, and her MA at Bilkent University with Fulbright scholarship. She directed many MA theses on various topics and two PhD theses on language assessment, working as a director and a researcher in various TÜBİTAK and BAP projects. Belgin Aydın Hocam presented at different national and international conferences and has been teaching courses including methodology in language teaching, teaching English to children, digital material development, and individual differences in language learning. As to today's topic, you know, this conference should have been online in April this year. However, due to the COVID pandemic globally affecting all of us, we're having it online. So all of a sudden, all educators have found ourselves in a situation where we're trying to have courses, online courses, or maybe having more courses in distance education centers or what. So today, Belgin Hocam will be talking about the experiences at TED University. Hocam.
Thank you very much, Gonca. So how many crazy people are there on a Saturday morning? Oh, we have almost 60. You didn't have a better option. Thanks a lot for coming. I will talk about distance education. It is not specific to teacher education, actually. I'll be talking about our journey at TED University, but I will start with a poll. I have 5 simple questions. The questions are simple, but the answers may not be. Let's start. Can you see the poll? Okay. Can you also see my screen now? Okay, good. It is nice to see you all. I cannot see you all, but it is nice to see the people I see. I see some names, I see some faces. All right, let me wait for a few seconds more and then end the voting. All right, so 39 people voted. I am sharing the results with you. The first question, I love online education. Wow, But that is much more than I expected. So you love your what you are doing online, but your students don't. All right. And the third one, I think online education is easy. You disagree. It is difficult. And I agree with you. Online education includes more opportunities for the students. The answer, I don't know. It is both yes and no. Actually, it includes lots of opportunities, but it depends on how you use those opportunities. And the fifth one, what we are doing now is not online education. Definitely, yes. What we are doing right now in the world, not only in Turkey, in the world is not online education. Okay, and as I say, we had some experience, as you have all this, since March 23. And I will be talking, Gonca actually asked me to talk about this experience. We have done some, let's see if it is good stuff or not. At the end of the presentation, we can talk about that. First of all, I would like to start with the distinction between distance education and emergency remote teaching. What we are doing now is not distance education or online education. I'll be using these two interchangeably here. I'm not going to talk about the difference between the two. What we are doing right now is just moving instruction into an online platform, because we had to find a solution, because we had a crisis situation. We have been still living in this pandemic period. But when we talk about online learning, there are actually lots of moderating variables we have to think about, and we have to design our teaching and learning. We have to talk about the modality. Is it going to be fully online? Is it going to be blended? We have to determine the pedagogy we are using. Assessment is a very big part, very important part of education. You know how we are going to organize our assessment needs to be determined before we start our education. What kind of a role instructors will have, the students will have, how we are going to carry out the communication, how we are going to give feedback to students. This is just one page of the variables, actually. There are more than what you see here. There is also a psychological and social component of online education. So what we are doing here, not here exactly, but today in the second term, since the beginning of this term, let's say, is not still online education, although we had some time because of, again, lots of different variables. I don't think we could arrange our education into an online platform as we should have done. Let me start by introducing TED University to the ones who are not familiar. It was established in 2009 by Turkish Education Association, TED, in Ankara. It is actually a small university, as you see from the numbers. We have only 5 faculties with 15 programs, with 10 graduate programs, and a prep school, of course. We have almost 4,500 students and 280 academicians. There are lots of centers of Tate University, but there is one which was established with the establishment of the university, and it is called CTL, Center for Learning and Teaching. And it is responsible for it is responsible for, let's say, facilitating students' learning and academicians' teaching, because active learning and student-centered learning is the education philosophy of TED University. Okay, after this brief introduction, let's start the journey now. You know, since March 23, we have been doing online education, and we were lucky because we were already very familiar with Moodle as LMS. All the teachers and all the students were already in Moodle, and we were using it asynchronously, and all the communication was carried out through Moodle. Feedback was given through Moodle. the assignments were shared through Moodle. So we were familiar with that. And the administration with IT department, of course, decided to use Zoom, and they bought Zoom and inserted it into Moodle system. And we had our own online synchronous classes through Zoom, which was a great help for us. And our IT technologies department trained 17 research assistants very, very quickly. And they had remote support for the academicians and for the teachers. So it was really a very quick adaptation for us. We were actually shocked how quickly both the students and the academicians adapted to the Zoom platform, and they started using it very successfully. This slide shows you some numbers to give you an idea about how intensely both synchronous and asynchronous components were used. I'm not going to talk about every detail, of course, but I would like to underline that it was used with all the classes we had at the prep school, at graduate level, at undergraduate level. And it was used intensely, as you see. We also shared Coursera for campus, as it was open for everybody. And we have happily seen that lots of students and teachers registered to lots of courses on Coursera. We also gave individual and group support to the students, especially at the prep school. But this slide, I think, is more important because our psychology department immediately organized a TEDxCOPS. I guess there is no problem. You can still see and hear me. All right, let's continue. Assuming that there is no problem.
No problem, Begüm Hocam, we can all hear you.
All right, Gonca. This is what happens during the classes too. You just talk, assuming that everybody is with you. Sometimes you realize that you are talking by yourself. All right, TEDxCOPS was established by psychology department, as I say, to help students experiencing coping problems with the pandemic period. Remember the beginning stages of the period, we were all anxious. We just did not know what to do, how to cope with it, how to cope with our own psychology, how to live in a different environment with our families, especially for the students. Some of them were alone. Some of them were alone in Ankara. Some of them had to go to their home towns. And they offered services, two types of services, actually. The first one was psychoeducation. They organized online psychoeducation groups. They prepared brochures, videos, but they also had counseling supports, and they gave organized individual counseling online sessions and peer interaction groups. And as you can imagine, our students were very happy with this support. Interviews, talks, and seminars were also organized by various teachers from the psychology department or from other departments. So the university was really active, not only in the classes and teaching, but on the other areas as well. I love this slide. This is my favorite slide because this shows some of the activities organized by our student groups. During this period, since March till June, I guess, they organized 32 different types of activities. For example, our theater group organized an improvisation activity. Our EduAction group organized a big conference, actually, online conference. Radio Teddy organized various types of online programs, Instagram programs. So as I said, this is my favorite slide. Okay, let's look at what we did at the Center for Teaching and Learning, CTL. First of all, there are, by the way, two people mainly working at CTL, me and we have Iknur. I'm sure Iknur is with us. Now she would be, I cannot see her name. I would like to thank her because we really worked hard together and it was enjoyable working with her. I'm presenting here today, but what I am presenting here today actually was organized by Iknur and me together. Okay, we first of all had a commission from one representative from each faculty because we thought if we have the decisions together, it will be more successful because we have different types of faculties like engineering faculty, education faculty, whose needs are completely different from each other. So this commission members helped us to give the right decisions. And then we shared some tips with them. I will be sharing them with you in a moment. And we evaluated what we are doing right after the first week of online education and at the end of the period. We had student seminars and academician seminars, and I will be talking about those things. Okay, we started with collecting some tips for the teachers, first of all, and we had some documents, videos, we thought they might benefit from. Although everyone was very quick in adaptation, there were still, of course, some ways of improving what we are doing. So we found out, for example, documents for using Zoom in a better way, or how to be a better online teacher, or how technology can be used in higher education, or how we can conduct more effective online discussions. We shared some online tools with the teachers, with the academicians, and with the students. We shared these documents with both groups. These are just examples. We shared some tools for different aims, like at puzzle, Flipgrid, screencasting, mind mapping. We also shared some teaching tips, like Bloom's digital taxonomy, or motivation, time management, or finding balancing family and career in one place. And we said as CTL, we are ready to have discussions on each document. And as I said, we evaluated the journey and we asked how students and academicians were perceiving this online education, whether they can participate, whether they are experiencing any problems, how they are defining, how they are perceiving this education, whether they are satisfied with the services we are providing to them. We asked their opinions on online assessment tools, the problems they experienced, and the suggestions they are offering to improve online education. I am not going to talk about each component of these surveys, of course, because we have four versions. We have two versions for the first week, right after the first week, to see how they are doing. And we have the final version evaluating the whole process. Now, let's have some interaction and talk about the problems our students might have experienced. I'm sure they are similar with your students. Can you please share what kind of problems they might have experienced, or what is the biggest problem in your opinion they experienced during this online education? I will be checking the chat box now to see your answers. I need to stop sharing, I guess, to check the checkbox. not willing to participate. Yes, distraction, social interaction is a big challenge. Mm-hmm. Ignor, you are here. I see your name now. Technological facilities, internet connection, limited interaction, mm-hmm. Not equal opportunities, unwillingness. Hi, Meray. I see people from Anadolu University. Hello to everyone. Communicative language teaching method. Mm-hmm. Distractions related to home life. Definitely, yes. Good morning. Motivation, assessment, seeing the face of someone is so important. Definitely, yes, Gonca. It is so nice to see your faces now. Lack of motivation, definitely, Gonca Burçak. Lack of technological foundations in educational institutions. Mm-hmm. Home life problems, yes. Inequality in the opportunities they have, definitely, Gökhan. The thought that it wouldn't be effective, not even participating. Digital divides. Mm-hmm. Okay, these are all true for our students too. They reported experiencing similar problems, relations. Yes, Dorota, that's true. But, okay, let me continue sharing my screen. They reported all these problems, as you said. They reported having technological problems. I guess you can see it now. Gonca, can you see? Okay, good. They reported not having technological equipment or internet connection. Since we were a small university and a private university, let me say, we helped with their technological disadvantages. We sent them tablets, computers, internet packages. So we didn't have that problem. We saw that problem immediately. But two other main problems were related to assessment and interaction during the classes. And we reported the results of the survey to the administrator right after the first week. And the administration decided to eliminate online assessment from the system, from the university system, and use progressive assessment instead, just because of our students' perceptions of online, because they were afraid that they would have technical problems during an online exam and it would affect them negatively. Online assessment will not measure their performance in a healthy way. So we have decided to use progressive assessment and edit the syllabus we are using and use projects, assignments, presentations, and reports instead. It was not a very big challenge for the teachers because, as you remember, active participation and student engagement is our educational philosophy. So progressive assessment was already taking place in many of the classes by many of the professors. And interaction was another problem reported by the students and by the teachers. They said in the classes, okay, we are using active learning, but in an online platform, I cannot help them to become active. I cannot, I use breakout rooms. I tell them to open their cameras, but there should be better ways of doing this. And then we went back to the teachers and asked, okay, can you please share the strategies you are using with us to encourage student participation to your classes? And we asked the same question to the students. We said, okay, interaction was reported as a problem. Can you share what your teacher does so that you can interact to your lessons? And can you also share your own strategies that works for having a better class, to interact better in the classroom? And we organized the ideas into Flipgrid. These are just one pages of these Flipgrids, actually, that there were really good ideas used by different teachers at different faculties. And with this infograph, we shared their ideas again with the teachers. We said, okay, this is what you are saying, you are doing, so we can learn from each other. And they did. They did. This really worked a lot. We shared students' opinions with the other students as well. We said, see, these are the strategies your friends are using. You might also use these strategies too. And this slide shows the suggestions they offered to us for more effective online learning. They said trainings to learn about distance education is necessary, especially for the academicians. They said, we are doing things. Okay, we are doing fine, but to be able to do better, we need to learn how to do it better. They said they need to find better ways of increasing student participation. And we were doing synchronous classes as the same amount of our face-to-face classes. They said this needs to be arranged. And synchronous classes, not all of them were recorded and shared with the students, so they all need to be recorded and shared, and more flexible assessment should be used. I will talk about what we did with those suggestions, but before that, we organized some seminars with the students. I would like to share this slide with you. We first of all started with sharing the survey results, especially the ones we did at after the first week. We said, okay, these are the ideas you shared with us. These are the problems you are experiencing. These are the good things you are doing. So we, for example, focusing, motivation, and interaction were the biggest problems, as I have already said. We shared some tips with them. Okay, you can organize your time better by using these strategies. These are the strategies which might help you to focus more in your classes. This was the first presentation. And then sometimes in Turkish, sometimes in English, we had seminars inviting guest speakers from other universities as well. We talked about effective communication strategies. We talked about how they can apply to a job during a pandemic period. We found two very good teachers. One of them already experienced a COVID-19 problem, and they shared, this was the beginning of the process, and we were still discussing whether we should use masks or not. And they had a great session with our students, informing them about this virus and the period. And with the teachers, we searched the literature, we talked to experts, and we have identified that for our trainers, we need to have a dynamic structure focusing on institutional needs. And we need to have a documentation system everyone can reach anytime, anywhere. And we need to bring open sources together, share experiences, and give support who needs one-to-one support. And we need to use institutional resources. Okay, these are the key points we identified from the literature. And then we started to establish the system as CTA. And what we did was organizing seminars on online education, first of all. Remember that this was a suggestion already given to us. And we again started by sharing the results of the overall evaluation of online education. And we shared both our students and academicians' opinions with our academicians, the problems they stated they experienced, the solutions they offered. And we had a nice discussion on how we can solve these problems and what can be done. And we came up with a model, understanding by design model, which was highly suggested to be used on online education. And we found an academician working on this model already at TED University, and we invited Zerrin to share what this model is and how we can apply it to our classes with all of us. And she did a great job. And assessment, as I said, was one of the main issues. And we found a great team to talk about online assessment, how it should be organized, and how we can use it at TED University. This was the first session, how we can prepare rubrics. And the second session was specific to using Moodle system for assessment. And then as a CTR commission, we had two different sessions on six different topics. We shared what kind of tools we can use, both synchronously and asynchronously, how we can have better videos and PowerPoint presentations or other presentations, how we can increase our students' interaction in our classes. This was the first session. And during the second session, we talked about how we can give more effective feedback to our students, online and face-to-face, actually. And we had a representative from psychology department. He talked about motivation and concentration. And we asked our prep school to share their experience with exams because they had a great job in applying different various types of assessment tools. And they shared their experience with the rest of the university during these seminars. But this was not enough. Remember, we said we need to have a system where everyone can refer to when they need it. We recorded all these seminars and meetings and the discussions we had afterwards. And we had a Moodle session called TEDU'de Uzaktan Eğitim, Distance Education at TEDU. And we shared all these links here with forums so that teachers could interact more. This was the first part of the course. And the second part, which I like more, was learning from each other. We found the teachers and they found us who said they are using different tools at their classes, which work. I will give you some examples in the next slide. And we also had free online courses session because our teachers reported us that if they experience this period as a student, it might help them to understand student perception better. So we share these courses with them. And we know that some of these courses were taken by some of the faculty members. Okay, this slide is related to learning from each other. With IGNU, we had a very brief introductory video recording. The aim of this part, this component, is really learn from each other because from different faculties with different needs, teachers were using great tools. We knew some of them because they shared their ideas in our surveys. We knew the others because they were around, or sometimes they came and they said, I can share this too with you during these videos. We had a Zoom meeting, ignore me and the teacher, and we had a very informal chat session. And the teacher talked about how they used this tool with the students, what kind of problems they experienced and how they solved those problems. And you see one slide again. I shared how I use Flipgrid, for example, Ignor shared how she used Padlet. And then we had a teacher from business administration and he talked about how he used gamification, whiteboard, Edpuzzle, ePortfolio, Flip Learning, Mentimeter, Perusal, Jigsaw, blocks. They were all shared by our teachers. This was really very enjoyable for us. I mean, shooting these videos. This was very enjoyable for the teacher presenting the tool they were using. This was very enjoyable for the other academicians because just like we did with the seminar videos, we had forum sessions just after each video so that teachers could interact with each other. For example, if I have a question related to perusal, I can ask Erdem further questions, and I know that he will help me. And before we started this semester, we prepared a checklist for teachers, which we hoped that they could use while preparing their courses. And there were some questions in the checklist and sometimes references, as you see here, from various sources. And we told them that, as we have already discussed during the seminars, they need to focus on the communication with the students and the assessment component, of course. And then they need to plan their experiences. I mean, by answering each question in this checklist, if they design their courses, they will not have many problems, we hope. We will ask how many of them really went over these checklists and designed their courses. What are we doing now? Now we have 12 technology-supported classrooms in which we can have hybrid education. And we are continuing to increase our academicians' technopedagogical competence. And we have a teaching innovation grant, which we are planning to give to the ones who can use technology effectively during this semester to their own times. And we have an orientation program for the new academicians. We also have student support. We have online mentorship. We share effective learning strategies with them, with Zoom meetings, with written documents. We will be talking about learner autonomy, all to have more effective learning and teaching at Tech University. Okay, this is a slide showing newcomers, new academicians. Studio hoş geldiniz, welcome to Tech University. We shoot videos with each administrator, let's say, the rector, the vice rector, with the deans of the faculties, with the head of the departments, also with the institutions they might need. And we had two Zoom meetings with them, one informing them about the registration process, the other informing them about how they can use Moodle and Zoom in a better way. And we have just recently had the third one, the orientation one with the new academician. This slide shows our mentorship program. These students are our mentors or lead mentors. I can give you further information at the end of the presentation if I have time. They started with the orientation program with the newcomer students, and they had a great job. And this is the Moodle course we have for the new students. Again, they have welcoming videos. They will have some useful materials. Okay, now let's talk about what we learned during all this process, the period, the journey. This is not specific to our university, I guess. As the whole world, we have seen how adaptable we can be if we have to. We had to increase our digital competence. We just had to. We didn't have any other choice, and we had to do that very, very quickly. But doing all these things, all these seminars, all the surveys, trying to help each other, all the videos, I believe increased sense of belonging to the institution. This is not my personal belief, by the way. This is the feedback we are getting. And I also need to say that we increase our assessment literacy, because during this period, we not only focused on how we can do it better in an online platform, but we also focused on what we are doing during our face-to-face classes as well. So to summarize, I need to say that learning is not a matter of information transformation, it doesn't only include cognitive process. You cannot just give the information to the students and expect them to learn. We need to do more than that. We need to consider the psychological and social aspects of that. I mean, if you are coming to a university, information is not the only thing you are expecting to learn as a student. And this is the other summary slide, let's say. So if we want to have successful online education, we need to invest in supporting learners with formal, informal, and social resources. And this is not true, I believe, only for successful online education. This is true for any type of education. And professional development opportunities are must. We definitely support our teachers with course design, content development, learning management system training, multimedia creation, and increasing their assessment literacy. So just get it online, just do your courses online approach should change into a design of learning environments that are flexible, inclusive, and student-centered, ensuring that all students can access and learn. All right, this was a part of our journey at Tech University. Now I will stop sharing my screen with you and would like to answer any questions if you have, now or later.
Okay, Belgin Hocam, thank you for the sharing the experience. Because just having the internet connection or buying Zoom or another kind of platform is not enough. You have, I especially like the psychological support that the instructors and the students and the coaching. Okay. Now, anyone else comments or Benal Hocam says you mentioned psychological components of online education. Can you elaborate that?
Benal Hocam. If I can, of course, I would love to. Hello, by the way, I miss you a lot. I miss you all. When we talk about psychological component of online education, I think we need to distinguish it from distance education and emergency distance education, because if you are doing distance education, online education, students are psychologically already ready. They know what they will be experiencing. They will be familiar about the process. They will be informed about the assessment. They will be informed about the whole system. So if they would like to continue, they will enroll the program and do this. But what we experienced was emergency remote teaching. And since this was emergency, we just had no ideas. I mean, education was not our first concern, actually, our health was our first concern. Our mental health was the second concern. But as you very well know, when we talk about psychological component, even in a face-to-face classroom, we know that our students need to feel safe. They need to feel safe that they are in that classroom with that teacher, with those students. So this safety feeling when done in an emergency teaching, it was not ensured at the beginning because nobody knew what we would experience. So we need to tell them that we are here with you. We are all experiencing problems. You are not alone. And if there is anything we can do, we can solve this problem together. So they need to, first of all, feel that they are safe, they are not alone, and there are people who are willing to help them. If we can ensure that, we cannot expect them to continue their education. And during the classes, again, social presence is a very important component of online education. They just need to be present socially as an individual, not only by opening their cameras during the classes, but they need to know that they are informed by the teacher, by the other individuals, and by the institution in and out of the classroom. both synchronously and asynchronously. They need to have feedback. They need to have some social activities. They need to have fun during these online courses. I mean, these are just a few ideas I can think of at the moment, but I'm sure there are more than that, Benarcan. We can have a discussion.
What I was wondering about was how you actually have students understand these concepts. Do you just talk about these concepts like safety, as you said, or motivation or interaction as part of the lesson, or do you train them in feeling safe and in you know, feeling motivated? That's what I meant, actually.
Both. We did both, because remember I talked about Teddy Cops, our psychology department had a Teddy Cops group, let me say, and they had information meetings, they had video recordings, they had one-to-one support, they had peer support, they had Zoom meetings, just focusing on their psychological well-being. So we everything we could do.
Excellent. Thank you. Wonderful presentation, by the way.
Thank you, Benarcan. Thank you very much. Do we have any other questions?
Gonca Hocam, can I say a couple of things?
Yes, of course.
Okay. Good morning, everybody.
So nice to see you.
So nice to see everybody. Familiar faces. Bergin Hocam, thank you for a wonderful presentation. I think this is a topic that we can all relate to when we think about the previous semester. I remember how our students and us, you see, we didn't know really what to do for a couple of days. Actually, more than that, we needed a transitional period. What I remember is during those 2 weeks, I think we showered our students with assignments, projects, more readings, because we had a lot of conscious buttering. We have this, you know, period. We have a scheduled class, but we're not really doing anything. So we had a lot of comments from our students. Actually, we conducted a similar research, probably part of it. We gave a questionnaire to all our students, and we realized that if we had synchronous sessions, then our students preferred asynchronous sessions and vice versa. So at one point we thought each group, each course, each student actually have different needs, and we decided to blend all of them. And the other thing is, I was lucky to have somebody at home. This is Tarkan Hoca's area of expertise. I was saying, I'm teaching this class for 3 hours in the department. So, but if I keep my students connected for 3 hours, this is really tiring. Plus, they have a lot of connection problems. And then I came across this article. It says, for each 40 or 50 minute face-to-face class, a 15 minute, you know, of equivalence of online education would do. I said, if I did that, I wouldn't be able to cover, you see, more than half of my sort of syllabus. That was another problem. So coming back to what Bergin Hoca just said about the psychological aspect, I think we needed to do a lot of counseling. When Bina Hoca was asking, did you have to explain it or did you have to do it? Most of the time, we had to make them feel safe and sound. Everything is going to be okay. And we learned to be more flexible. And of course, that wasn't proper remote education, as Bergin Hocam said. It was emergency and everybody was freaking out about what to do. Plus, what I remember was we had a couple of funny episodes when the, when the student would think that the camera was off, but actually it was on. So the student would be sort of rolling their eyes. I'm an idiot, so this teacher, you know, this sort of person is killing us here. What are you going on about? A couple of episodes like similar to what Sula experienced in social media. So we had really amusing, fruitful experiences. I think this semester we're more prepared, okay, about what to do. We're more planned, but we know that nothing would be equal to the real thing. And we do hope very soon we'll go back to our old days. Thank you.
But there is a lot we learned during this period, actually. I don't think we will be the same people when we go back to our classes. We shouldn't be, actually. Yeah. What we also realized during this period was this. As teachers, we are trying to teach too much. And teach, I would like to underline this.
Indeed.
Also trying to assess everything we teach. This was something we realized, actually. And this shouldn't continue this way when we go back to, I mean, whatever we do, it can be both online or face-to-face, doesn't matter.
Yeah.
And the last question, remember, at the beginning of the session was, online education provides more opportunities to students. I believe in this idea, actually. If we design it really carefully, we can provide more opportunities to the students. Because it is not only me teaching this stuff, there is a better person in a better way, in a more enjoyable way, in a more interactive way, and students can go and find that source, or I can find that source and share it with the students.
Mm-hmm.
And this collaborative environment, Gökhan, thank you very much for your comment, by the way. I think this was the biggest achievement we had at TED University. We really created a collaborative environment, and now we are expecting for the next CTL meeting because we are enjoying it. We are learning from each other. Are there any other questions? There are really nice comments. Thank you very much, Doreta. Thank you very much, Asuman. Peer coaching is really doing great, and students are doing great. That we definitely share the same perspective, the same challenges, the same problems. Thank you, Samsung Galaxy. Arzucum, thank you very much.
It looks like participation, getting the students to talk, to interact was the biggest problem, right?
Yes, hocam. Interaction and assessment, they were the biggest problems. But I don't think assessment is specific to online education. Assessment is a problem we have all the time. We need to increase our assessment literacy any time we can find the opportunity.
Yeah, indeed.
May I have a screenshot and share it in my Instagram account with you, with your camera?
Yes, you're welcome.
Go ahead, hocam.
Okay, I have.
Great.
I hope I was smiling.
Yeah, thank you very much for being here with me on a Saturday morning, early Saturday morning.
Thank you, Belgin Hocam, for everything. Because as you have said before, we suddenly found ourselves in a situation which cannot be technically described as distance education because it's not planned in that way. It's emergency remote teaching. Out of a sudden, you find yourself in a place where you cannot have the face-to-face one. You somehow have to transfer it to another platform. So everybody, because I looked at the chat box and have read the comments, this was, well, even in the other countries, people experienced similar problems and colleagues try to help each other. And it's nice to see an institutional one, and this is probably something we can learn from. Especially I like the coaching, which is totally in line with constructivist way of learning. And also the psychological support as well. Thank you for everything.
Let me say one more final sentence. It has to be institutional. Otherwise, you can be a perfect teacher, but it doesn't help your students if it is not institutional. All these decisions, all these infrastructure, all the actions, it must be taken institutionally.
Thank you. Now we can have, in a few moments, we will be moving to our next plenary, Yasemin Kırkgöz Hocam, and she's here. Hello, hocam. Yasemin hocam, actually we have a few minutes, maybe she's getting prepared for that. Okay. Okay, people would like to attend to seminars with more practical tips.
Anytime.
Belgin hocam, do you share your seminars or the documents or all the nice visuals about practical tips?
Gonca, what we shared with our Moodle courses are actually specific to our institution because there were institutional concerns.
Institution specific.
Institutional topics, but we can share with the other people anytime. We can have meetings or, I don't know the format now, but we would like to share our experience, of course, if it is not institutional. Because these video the seminars were recorded with the permission of the participants.
Definitely.
If you share those videos, we have to get clear permission for sharing as well. Because this was an institutional sharing permission.
Okay. Hocam, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for being here on a Saturday morning.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. Now I'm going to...